Most of the festival-goers had now drifted out of the dance and into the street to see what was going on. A monstrous pall of dirty black smoke hung over the hotel, illuminated by flashing blue lights. Emergency vehicles were parked 10 deep by the building's incongruous fake portico, and dozens of police officers roamed about looking busy and purposeful. And everywhere there were reporters and camera crews in their onesies or in jackets thrown over their nightwear, getting in everyone's way, asking for opinions, and thanking their lucky stars that they'd been right there, on scene, when whatever had happened had happened. They did pieces to camera, describing, not always accurately, the events of the weekend so far. The horrific murder of a so far unidentified woman at the village hall, the possibly sinister deaths of 2 other women in a car crash, the disappearance of a prominent solicitor, and several leading lights in the world of Agnes Crabb fandom. The possible abduction of TV star Helen Greeley, and now what appeared to be a terrorist attack on the hotel that had seriously injured a handful of festival-goers, including Miss Penny Berrycloth, yet another important fan club figure. Conspiracy theories abounded. Chief Superintendent Edwin Newton Atkinson, commander of Boaster Division, had turned out to try to explain to the reporters why his officers had failed to prevent any of these events from happening. As he spoke, he jumped whenever another oil can exploded. For many of the Millies, the lure of the strobing blue lights and cameras was too much, and they were drawn towards them like sharks to a wounded seal. In the confusion, no one noticed as 2 of the Miss Cutter lookalikes headed out of the village towards the small group of houseboats moored on the canal near the Dunksbury Road Bridge. For Mrs. Dallimore, sitting all alone in the pitch black of the old boat's hull, the night brought different terrors.